It's not a very pretty sight. But she loved God. And she wasn't going to deny her Lord. She wasn't going to deny her Savior. It would be easy to do. And the cost, whoa, she'd get to live. She wouldn't have to suffer. But she counted the suffering for Christ worth her life. For our light affliction. In Hebrews 12 and verse 11, now this is a verse I threw in there, so I don't think you're going to find it in the... You're not going to find it in there, but Hebrews 12 and verse 11, it says, now, no chastening. No chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who are trained thereby. Chastening. Generally, we get to thinking that chastening has to do with some kind of, with the word punishment. And it has nothing to do with punishment. It has to do with training. And in training, we will chasten. And it's done for our profit, never to punish, never to tear us down. It's given to make us stronger. And at the time that we experience it, it's not a very pleasant situation. But remember, God is with us, and He will deliver us, not from it, but through it. How do we respond to evil around us? That's the next section I want to deal with today. How do we respond to the evil around us? There's evil everywhere. Your kids go off to school and they find evil in school. Oh, it may be tempered there, it may be mild, but they find evil. There's evil everywhere, and we have to deal with it. We can all look around us and we can all see evil. It hurts. It grieves. It causes a lot of pain. We look at the question again, why? We want to address more of our response to it. How are we to respond to what we see? How do we respond to the evil around us? You turn on the television and there's an evil program on. It's not fit for the children to see. And if it's not fit for the kids to see, what makes you think it's okay for you to see? What in the world do you think you're teaching your children if you tell them, now you got to go to bed because we're going to watch this program? Now, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. You're not going to help your children. You've got to live the faith. You've got to live the truth. You've got to live Jesus Christ all the time. First of all, the way we address it is to realize God allows sin to take its natural course. Okay? Sin comes like a wave, and God's going to allow it to take its course. Why? Why does God allow it to affect you and me? God has a purpose in it. It's not to tear you down, it's to make you strong. It's not going to make you strong if you're not trusting God through it. If you're not realizing that God is still in control. Like the martyrs of the 10th, 11th centuries, the martyrs, they knew that God was in control. And they knew that on the other side, when that pain and suffering has completed its course, they would be in the presence of Jesus. And sometimes that's something you need to remember. As you're facing any kind of a trial, it brings you that much closer to Jesus. It brings you that much closer to His presence. I tell you what, I have seen folks, I have seen believers, usually aged believers, who have known God, who have experienced God, and you can see the face of God in their faces because they have trusted Him through hard times. They have trusted Him through trying times. They've trusted God. Look with me at the book of Galatians for a minute. Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. Okay. It says, let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that he shall also reap. For he who sows of his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life.
Amen.
God is justly allowing man's sinfulness and the curse it brought upon the earth to take its natural course. But remember, God is in control. God is in control. The earth and humanity are broken and they're longing for redemption. Redemption will come. Because of man's sin, beginning with Father Adam, the earth itself is broken and waiting for redemption. The earth is ripping itself apart because of sin. Volcanoes, earthquakes, it's ripping itself apart, and it's going to get much more violent and much more radical in the times yet to come. God allows suffering. He allows suffering even for His own people. Mark it down. We're going to experience some difficult times, but be of good cheer. God has overcome the world. Trust Him. In Matthew 5, verse 44. Matthew 5 and verse 44. Jesus says, but I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven. For He makes His sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. Yes, they receive blessings from God. When you and I get to thinking they ought to be cursed by God, God still sends them blessing. And He sends us hardness. God is equal. God is fair. God is just. For them, it is a part of their downfall. But for you and me, it's a part of our building and strengthening. Even if it's unto death. You know, you look at some of the early Christian martyrs. Look at Stephen, that was stoned to death. He just barely got started in his Christian faith. He didn't know Jesus very well and very long, but he trusted Him. And one day he was standing amongst a crowd, and he was preaching to them the Lord Jesus. And they started to pick up stones and throw those stones at him until he was dead. God could have very easily have stopped that. But God says, I'm taking you home, son. You have finished your course. You have run the race and you've been faithful to me. But he could have done so much more. He finished his course. And God will let you finish your course. And then he will take you home however he chooses. He's referring to suffering and our response to it. Well, we like to hear of people that God miraculously delivers from suffering. Like Daniel. He was thrown into the den of lions. And God stopped their mouths. Next day, the king rushed over, opened the lid up, and said, Daniel, are you still alive? He said, oh, yeah, I'm down here enjoying breakfast with the lions. You know, We like those stories. We like to think that God will deliver me. But we read of many others, God didn't choose to deliver. God delivered them through the persecution, not from the persecution. Nature The nature of all stories is our heroes. And we like to see our heroes win the battle. We like to see our heroes delivered. Unfortunately, they're not always delivered. In Isaiah 46 and verse 10. Isaiah 46 and verse 10, Isaiah says, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. God says, my counsel will stand. God is in control. There's a lot of evil things happening in this world. I'm not saying roll over and just let it happen. Do what you can. Do what you can to stand against it. Do what you can, but understand this. In the end, God is in control. Yes. If you win, you win. If you don't, you win. Okay? Because God is on your side. Amen. God is on your side. God is sovereignly working in infinitely complex plan involving human beings, cultures, governments, and even the natural world over a millennia of history. Yeah. God is carefully working through it. God was not surprised by Adolf Hitler. He was not surprised by Pol Pot. He was not surprised by the Chinese Red Guard. He was not surprised by any of this. God knew, and he allowed it to happen. And the stories that you're going to hear in heaven, the stories you're going to hear in heaven of those who God delivered through it, you won't hear those stories in this life, but you will hear them then, because God is master. He is indeed in control. I'm not a pessimistic kind of guy. I am not. I'm very much an optimist. I do believe God is in control and we're going to win in the end. But I also believe this. This world is not getting sweeter. This world is not getting nicer. And what we saw last century, we're going to see it probably even worse this century. Because the heart of man is deceitful, it's desperately wicked, and who can know it? Yes. And evil is on the rise. Yes. You need to understand who you are. You need to understand what side you're on. Yes. And you need to understand that you're on the winning side in Jesus Christ. Yes. That winning side may not save your life. It may cost you your life. But you're on the winning side. Yes. And don't be afraid. Don't ever turn back. Don't ever let down. God is sovereignly. I mean, there is nobody else that controls or manipulates him. He is sovereign. He is sovereignly working an infinite complex plan involving human beings. That's you. That's me. We will let it play out. We will fight where we can fight. We will stand where we can stand. We will fall where we will fall. But we will not fall from God's grace. We will not fall from His good pleasure and His goodness, grace, and mercy. God allows sin to take its course. I trust in God working out His plan. We do not always know what God is doing. We don't always know what His plan is, but we can know He is sovereign, and ultimately, he will finish his story. I like to think that we're coming closer to that end than we even know. I really do. I like to think that we're coming close to that day when the trumpet's going to sound. When the trumpet of Christ sounds and the dead rise again. We're coming closer to that. But I know that we're not there yet. There's still some things that we're waiting on. Okay? But God is bringing us so much closer. God knows what's going on. And there are no surprises to God. We have some pictures of some folks somewhere up here. Okay. You know these three people, don't you? You know these three people. I came into New Zealand a few weeks ago, a couple of weeks ago now, and I found out who the Prime Minister was. I didn't know. Sorry. You look at these three people. Is God surprised at how it came out in the end? Is God surprised? No, he's not surprised. He knew how it was going to come out. Look at the next slide. Is God wondering how that's going to turn out? Is God wondering how is this going to come together? No, God's not. God's not. He's not surprised. His will is going to be fulfilled in Daniel 2. In Daniel chapter 2, just follow me up there on the board. Daniel 2 and verse 20. Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are His, and He changes." He changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. God knows. And there's nothing going on that God is not aware of, that God's not dealing with. Why is there evil in this world? Well, simply put, because man brought it into the world. It came through one man. Now wait a minute. Why should you be responsible for Father Adam's stupid behavior? Why should you be responsible for it? Do you have any ideas? Why are you responsible for it? It's a human thing, okay? It's a uniquely human thing. It is because of the fact that we are responsible for His behavior that Jesus Christ is able to die for us without us dying on the cross. If we will believe Him and trust Him, we will have everlasting life. What Jesus did, He was able to do for all humanity. It's a human thing. Yeah. Adam was in the Garden of Eden. He was in a beautiful place. He had everything he wanted. And God told him, there's a tree in the middle of the garden. Don't eat it. And he went over and he saw it and he thought, it looks pretty good. His wife grabbed the fruit. She took a bite. And he says, hey, wait for me. And we've all entered into sin. Why should I suffer for Adam's behavior? It's that human thing. God made it that way. And because He did, one could die to redeem me. Jesus, the Son of God, came and He bled and died. He suffered in my place. Because He lives, I live. It's a human thing. It's not true with any other creature on the face of the earth. It's a human thing. We can be grateful that Adam had his choice. We can be grateful that God gives us a choice. We can choose to trust Jesus, or we can choose to reject Him. These things are not surprises to God. I trust that God is accomplishing a greater good. Point number three. I trust that God is accomplishing a greater good. God can use suffering to force us to seek Him. How many times have we known people cry out to God, God, what's going on here? God, can you help me through this? And then things come to mind that were told in the past and brings them to Jesus. You see, that's why it's important for you to be a faithful witness for Jesus Christ. To be able to share your faith with people, and when they turn their backs or scorn you or curse at you, they've heard the word. And something may come up later on in his life where he remembers that and he responds to it. Yes. God is uses suffering to force us to seek him. To force us to seek him. In Acts 17. Acts 17. Verse 26. Okay, you've got it up on the board, I don't. It's in here. Acts 17, verses 26 and 27. I'm getting there. 17, verse 26. And he has made from one blood every nation of man to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. Verse 27, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. God has made of one blood, all these nations. You know, we discovered years ago at IBC that we are all of one blood. Doesn't matter the color and shape of our faces. None of that matters. We're all one. There's only one race of humanity. And don't believe the garbage that's being fed to us. There's only one race of humanity. That's the human race. We're all children of Adam. It was the rebellion at the Tower of Babel that split the nations. And as it split the nations, it split the seed of man. And so the different family groups began to develop. And there are many weaknesses that develop with them. There is a peculiar disease for the Jewish people. A peculiar disease that is basically just found amongst Jewish people. There is sickle cell anemia for black people in America. For black people generally. That's unique to them. Why is it unique to them? Because the races, the families split apart. If we came back together again, all that could change very, very likely. I don't know. I'm not that kind of a scientist. God is refining us through fire. God is refining us through fire, through the trials, through affliction, through the difficulties that we face. In Job, chapter 36 and verse 15. Job 36 and verse 15, Job says, indeed, he would have brought you out of dire distress into a broad place where there is no restraint, and what is set on your table would be full of richness. God is refining us through fire. God provides for us, and he keeps things away from us. Mm-hmm. But God is blessed. And God blesses us and looks after us. God meets our needs.
Amen.
God is equipping us for a greater service to mankind. Not service just for each other, but service to mankind. In Hebrews 2 and verse 18. Hebrews 2 and verse 18. The writer speaks to us and tells us, "For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted." You see, Jesus knows. He knows what you're going through. And he is able to provide an answer. He is able to comfort us in what it is that we experience, the trial, the difficulty that we have experienced. I have experienced some real trials. You know, I look at the lives of missionaries, and I think of Pastor Irwin. And Pastor Irwin grew up in a fairly affluent family from Indonesia. The family, they had a dollar or two. They weren't poor people. They were comfortable. Irwin grew up in a comfortable lifestyle. He lacked nothing. But God called him to be a missionary. Okay? Now, why couldn't God have just called him to be a missionary, sent him to Bible school, and then sent him out on a mission field? Because Pastor Irwin had some lessons to learn. The number one lesson that Pastor Irwin had to learn was how to depend on God for his daily provision. He had to learn that. Because he's going to have to depend on God for everything from that point on. And he's asking, "Pastor Irwin, can you deal with it?" And he took him to the bottom of the barrel. Took him right down to the bottom of the barrel. I'm not surprised if Irwin's dad would have been happy to have sent him all the money he needed. But I think his dad had some knowledge too. And his dad had this idea that he's got to work through it. He's got to work through it. And he did. He did. But he knows what it is to do without. And since then, God has blessed him. God takes care of him. God did the same thing to me and my wife. He got us to a point where we had nothing. We were totally removed from our parents. Totally removed. My father told me when we left California to go to Bible college, he said, "Do you think when you get to Bible college that when you run out of food, God's going to send you food from heaven?" He said that to me. And I said, "No, I don't know what God's going to do, but I've got to do what God wants me to do." And God took us through the same situation. He took everything away from us. Everything. Everything. We had nothing. I went off on a trip to an army base to invite soldiers to church for the next Sunday. And I left my wife and my three little ones. I left them at home. And all they had in the refrigerator was a little bit of cheese. That's all they had. There was nothing else in the cupboard. There was that little bit of cheese. Janet cut some and gave it to Ken. By then, Ken had a gutful of it. And he said, "I don't want it." He was just 2 years old, or a year and a half. And he threw it down. He said, "I don't want any more of this." God has to bring us, he has to bring us down so that we can learn what it is to depend on him. And God may want to do that to you. He may not. I don't know. I don't know what your assignment is with God. I don't know your assignment. God knows your assignment. And whatever it is that you experience, trust him. Trust him. He's going to take care of you. He's going to look after you. And then in the end, he'll provide for you in a much sweeter way than you've ever imagined. Mainly because you know it's God's provision. You know it's God. God is equipping us for greater service to mankind. I remember my wife and I meeting.